everybody, and thank you very much for attending this afternoon's webinar on how to profit from the falling oil price using short-term ETP. I'll give you the overview of this webinar. Really, it's a summary, essentially just four bullets. We will kick off this webinar with giving you an overview of the size and growth of the short and leveraged oil ETP industry. I think then we will move on by discussing some of the mechanics pertaining to short and leveraged ETP. So specifically, how would you want to trade these products, and what kind of market conditions should you be holding such products for either long or short-term investment periods? We'll also touch upon the macro case and the valuation case for oil. What are market participants expecting of the oil price near term? What's the fundamental story behind the trends we've seen in the oil price as of late? And last but not least, we'll provide you some examples of trading short and leveraged ETPs with the purpose of hedging your long position. And after that, there'll be room for a Q&A session. So we would basically like to kick off this webinar with introducing Boost ETP to the audience. Boost ETP is a provider of short and leveraged ETPs. Last year, WisdomTree took a strategic stake in the company. It basically bought 75% of equity capital in an attempt to grow the business in Europe and help us expand the Boost platform alongside this. Really, what you can see in this chart is essentially a summary of the growth trajectory of Boost short and leveraged ETP product portfolio. We've had really enjoyed tremendous growth since our first listing on the London Stock Exchange, where we have introduced short and leveraged ETPs tracking equity and commodity markets. And ever since, due to numerous other listings in Italy on the Borsa Italiana, as well as in Germany on the Frankfurter Börse and Stuttgart Börse, we've really seen our AUM growth quite tremendously. A lot of the growth has actually come on the back of the commodity suit, and in particular oil. So as you can see on the chart to the left, where we break down the assets under management by asset class, roughly around $140-150 million is sitting in commodity ETPs. Predominantly, this is driven by creations in ETPs tracking WTI crude oil. But of course, alongside the commodity suite, we also have other asset classes, in particular equities, which has also grown over the last number of years, and a small portion of which is fixed income. You can also see that on the chart to the right that we've been able to grow the trading volume on the exchanges quite substantially over the last number of years. This is a very healthy indicator, because with rising trading volumes come lower spreads. So it is a good indicator of increased liquidity as more and more investors come to the fore and embrace such products as tactical investment vehicles. You will see that on the Borsa Italiana, very often one of our products, in particular natural gas and crude oil, is one of the leading volume makers on those markets. To give you an example, in the first week of March, we had a share of 23% in the ETC ETN segment on the Borsa Italiana. So what are short and leveraged ETPs? I think in this page we'll try to give you the bird's eye view of what they really are. I think first and foremost, if we compare short and leveraged ETPs to plain vanilla Delta 1 ETFs, and they're very similar in many aspects. First and foremost, they are liquid products. They trade on major stock exchanges in the world. There you'll have continuous pricing on such products, real time, with relatively tight spreads, i.e. the bid-ask spread that you would see on a short and leveraged ETP is not that much different from an unlevered ETC if you adjust for the leverage factor. Of course, the higher the leverage factor pertaining a short leverage ETP, generally the higher the cost is in constructing and manufacturing them, and that will transcend itself to a bit higher trading costs. But overall, adjusted for the leverage factor, you will find that the bid-ask spread is very comparable to the ETF markets and ETF products in general. What also stands out is that you trade these products on the secondary market, unlike, for instance, other derivative products, where more often than not, the counterparty is typically the issuer itself. So there you encounter a lot of counterparty risk. In our short and leveraged ETP construct, we choose to mitigate such counterparty risk by also providing collateral protection, so as to help to manage the counterparty risk. In essence, what the collateral does, it adjusts along the movements in AUM given by creations and redemptions, as well as the composition of which is adjusted by the credit rating assigned to the swaps provider. So if there's any deterioration in the credit quality of the swaps provider, the collateral will adjust in allocation towards more safer securities such as money market securities and fixed income securities. So overall, we try in our best efforts to mitigate all operational financial risks where possible. And in the end, the product looks as though it's in a very transparent, stable, liquid product that is very similar to a plain vanilla ETF. How do they work? Well, we guarantee the geared or leveraged or short return on a daily basis through a daily rebalancing process. And what it really means is that if an index that the ETP is tracking rises by 1%, the triple leveraged ETP would rise by 3 times the performance of that index. So if the index rises by 1%, you would be making 3% on that day. Of course, if the market has moved against you and the index has fallen, you would have lost 3%. It's a cash product. And with a cash product, we mean you cannot lose more than the money that you've invested. So with building a short position, it's not like you borrow money. No, you buy an ETP that is essentially a short product or a short product on the underlying index. And in this example, too, if the underlying index you're looking to short falls by 1% and the gearing factor of the short ETP is 3 times, you'll be making 3% on that day. Again, if the market moves against you and the market has risen, you've lost 3%. Now, one thing that is really important in ETPs tracking commodities such as WTI crude oil is that to get the exposure to the underlying, you actually are buying or getting exposure to the future. You cannot really get the spot price. You can only get an approximation to the spot price through the future contract. And oil futures are available on exchanges. You have different kinds of oil futures. You have oil futures maturing very far out in the maturity spectrum. You have oil futures that are close to expiry date. And if we plot the spectrum of contracts maturing over different horizons in a chart like we've done here, then what you can see is that there's a curve. Now, all oil markets can be in, as we call, contango or backwardation. And this is really what it means is we try to describe whether contracts that are closer to expiry are approaching the spot price or moving away from it. If contracts approach the spot price and the futures contracts further out in the maturity spectrum are higher than the spot price, it means that the curve is essentially in contango. And any investor that chooses to hold the oil future in such a market would then suffer from essentially a price decline. If a market is instead in backwardation, i.e. future prices further up in the maturity spectrum are lower then future prices nearing expiry and are closer to the spot price, then actually as you hold the contract closer to expiry, you stand to gain because the prices are climbing up. And so we try to summarize this in this chart where we essentially provide you the breakdown of the total return to any investor wishing to get an exposure to oil with buying futures. And what we see here is that, say, on the 31st of May 2013, you want to get exposure to oil and you buy a WTI crude oil contract that matures in December 2014, so approximately 1.5 years from now. And over time, you are seeing a shift in the maturity curve or in the futures curve where it steepens, it becomes more downward sloping. You've actually gained over a 12-month period, having still 6 months of expiry left. And at that time when you then choose to sell out of the contract, you've actually generated a spot return from around when you first bought it at $78.6 a barrel, and then you sell it at $99.2 a barrel. So that's essentially your spot return. But of course, many investors want to choose to stay exposed to oil, and so as you approach the maturity of the contract and you want to roll over and incur a roll yield, you buy the new contract, basically a December 2014 contract, the price of which is 91. The net difference, of course, is between the price that you paid, 78.6, the price that you sold, 99.2, and then when you buy back, and then you buy again another contract for $91 a barrel, and you'll see you've actually made a gain, either in price terms or in the number of contracts held. The real message here is, depending on the shape of the futures curve, you can either gain or lose depending on what kind of ETP you're having. Whether you're having a short ETP or a long ETP really depends on the shape of the curve. Generally speaking, if the curve is in contango, then short ETPs tend to benefit. If the curve is in backwardation, like we see here, long ETPs or leveraged ETPs tend to benefit. A quick overview of the growth of the short and leveraged ETP universe broken down by leverage factor. I think it's important to conceptualize the size of this industry. It's around $62 billion in assets under management on February 2015. Most of ETPs out there in the market today offer leverage factors anywhere between -3x and +3x. Most of the +3x and +2x ETPs track equity ETPs. Within the ETPs tracking with leverage factors of -2x, -1x, most of those sit in equities again, but a substantial bit is also in fixed income ETPs. You can see that if you break down assets by the AUM by asset class, around 10% of those ETPs track commodity indices and also single commodity benchmarks such as WTI crude oil. We gauge this market to be around 3 billion of SNL ETPs tracking crude oil. And interestingly, what we have seen over at least the last 6 months, a significant increase in asset under management in that space. Here we show this growth in ETPs, short leverage ETPs tracking crude oil, and the growth has very much been driven by inflows into the long ETPs or the leveraged ETPs that enable investors to position bullishly on the product. Actually, since the start of the year, more than $1 billion flew into such products. And as a result, AMM has grown quite significantly on the back of that. What's also interesting is not depicted here, but if you were to overlay the oil price against it, then you can see that more often than not, short and leverage investors position themselves as contrarians against the trend, perceiving trying to take advantage of the volatile move of commodities overall. So, and that in an upward trending market, if it's characterized by large up and down swings, you can still profit short term by holding either long or short positions. Of course, in this example where oil prices have come down, you should have actually benefited by taking short positions. But short leverage investors often being contrarians, they've actually tried to benefit by positioning themselves bullishly. So we are now arriving at a very important aspect of short leverage ETP investing, and namely that investors need to discriminate the kind of market conditions they are finding themselves in. You can have a trending market condition or you can have a volatile market condition. Now, why is this important? It is important because of a factor called compounding. Most conventional asset classes are subject to compounding. Consider a technology stock such as Apple. If Apple goes down by more than 2%, for it to restore its value at the previous day, it needs to recover by more than 2% to get back to the same level. This story is no different than with short leverage ETPs, but given the gearing factor implied in the ETP, it amplifies the effect of compounding. And we try to showcase this here in this slide, where in a trending market condition, we assume the underlying index indicated by the orange bar rises by 2% every day for the next 10 days. Had you held a leveraged long position on the index by buying, say, a ETP with a leverage factor of 3x, then over a 10-day holding period, your total return would be around 80%, as shown in the chart underneath the bar chart on the top left. And so what it tells you that in a trending market condition, you tend to exceed the expected return by more than 3x. Whilst in a very volatile market, where markets are basically moving up and down, you would not want to be holding the short leverage ETP for very long. There, in such market conditions, it's always advised to have a very short-term investment period in mind. Because if you don't do that, you are subject to the decay effect that sets in. And so volatile ETPs should generally compel investors to consider investment horizon of probably maybe no more than a couple of days only. While in trending market conditions, you want to be holding these products maybe for a number of weeks. So a great example of a market in trend was when we consider what happened to oil in the summer of last year. What we see here in this chart is essentially the oil price performance since July 2014, essentially to date. And we've seen that there's been a downtrend in crude oil, specifically WTI crude oil. And it has been quite a significant downturn to the tune of 55% from July 2014 to date. So a significant drop in the oil price. And the trend has been really characterized by very little up movement and generally strong price declines. And in such a market condition, which is quite unique to oil, I have to say, because the product or the asset class by nature is generally very volatile, had you held such a short ETP tracking crude oil for a number of weeks, or even months, you would have really been able to achieve quite substantial returns. And that was very hard to call a market correctly, so what we've done on the chart to the right is to produce calendar month returns in that time frame, where we overlay the calendar month return of the underlying, which is WTI, indicated by the red bars, versus the triple short ETP checking the underlying, or the inverse product essentially. You can clearly see that in a number of months, including July, October, November, and December, we've exceeded the performance by more than three times, driven very much by the downtrend. And this also tries to portray the product not just as purely very short term, but it can actually work over investment periods of a number of weeks as well. So it is very important investors discriminate the kind of market condition they are finding themselves in, if the market is volatile or if the market is in a trending fashion. Another great example, what happened to oil in around 2008. If you all recall, there was a big rally in oil in around 2007, leading up to the summer of 2008, when oil was quoted at around $135 a barrel, and then it crashed. Now, our ETPs didn't exist back then, but we've done a backtest on it, and you can clearly see that how strong a leveraged long oil ETP would have performed in such conditions. It is just to showcase the potential returns you could achieve without trying to say you would have, you know, how easy it is to actually to play the market. But the return potentials are quite dramatic. If WTI oil delivered 130% over time frame of January 2007 to around June 2008, a triple leverage long position on crude oil would have given the investor a 540% return on investment. Of course, in a downturn, the triple short has done phenomenally well. You would have done more than 10 times the return of the underlying. So in the period of July 2008 to the end of 2008, the underlying fell by almost 70%. We did more than 600%. I think it is really important that investors understand volatility, and in particular for those investors who seek exposure or a leveraged exposure to commodities, because commodities are, many of these are even more volatile than equities. We try to showcase this in this chart here, where we, rather than looking at standard deviation, which is the conventional volatility measure, we summarize the monthly returns distribution, essentially calculated over time period from 1998 all the way to December 2014, capturing many market cycles along the way. And what we are seeing here is this typical candlestick chart where you have the average return and the plus and minus one standard deviation from the average return, really indicated by the thick bars. And then you got these peaks, these thinner lines on top of stacked on top of them, and underneath the thicker lines showcasing the top 20 average return of the top 20% and the average return of the bottom 20%. And the dispersion of that clearly shows that within commodities, crude oil and natural gas in particular stand out as being those asset classes that shows the widest dispersion, or those assets that are very, very volatile indeed. And this showcases again that investors should consider short investment periods when seeking geared exposure to short leverage ETPs on such asset classes. And this is quite important, especially when you want to have exposure to natural gas, for instance. The volatility readings are often four times as more volatile than what you would see on the FTSE 100, for instance. Now, there are other things to consider when you choose to play commodities in a geared way. For instance, seasonality and also speculation. Especially in commodities, and particularly in oil, many contracts that you see traded on NYMEX or the Intercontinental Exchange, many of those contracts are traded by speculators as opposed to commercial traders who choose to hedge or lock in a price for the longer term. And what we're trying to showcase here in this slide, first of all, to the left, is the spike in implied volatility in crude oil seen since the summer of last year, driven, of course, first by the sharp decline in the price, but also, I believe, very much driven by speculators coming to the fore seeking a second position on crude oil. And if we were to relate the speculative positioning versus non-speculative positioning, then what we are seeing in the brown-gray line or the brown-gray area in the chart to the right is that leading up to the crash in the oil price, speculators were excessively bullishly positioned to the tune of 20% of open interest. So a lot of contracts that were net long by speculators as opposed to commercial traders. And of course, when the oil price started falling, they rapidly unwind their long positions from around 20% of open interest to around 12% of open interest today. And this unwinding may have driven the sharp decline in the oil price as a result. So investors choosing to play commodities need to be aware of the nature of speculators that can influence commodity prices substantially. Now, what about the fundamentals? The fundamentals for oil have been generally quite weak over the last year. And, you know, much of the rally in oil price, essentially since the sharp correction of 2008 that I've shown you previously, has come on the back of strong demand from emerging market economies, led, of course, by China. And if we were to look at the global oil consumption and we break it down by geography, as we have done in the chart to the right, then you can see that most of the increase in consumption came from emerging market economies. And what we are seeing here is that in around 2011, 2012, and 2013, demand exceeded well over 1.5 million of barrels in crude oil consumption over the time period, led predominantly by emerging market economies, even as developed market economies such as in Europe and in the US cut back on consumption. But what we have seen last year is actually that even emerging market economies have drastically cut back on consumption to the tune of almost 800,000 barrels per day compared to 2013, again led by China and emerging market economies. So the decline in growth or the contraction in growth is probably has compelled many traders to position bearishly on oil and drive the price lower. And we see that within the commodity space, it's really oil rather than anybody else, and yet any sector that has really driven the downbeat sentiment in commodities as such. There's also a correlation, as we see, between copper prices and oil prices, again showcasing that China and emerging market economies, whose growth have been very much driven by construction and investment spending, where copper is, of course, a key ingredient, that both copper prices and oil prices have tended to be highly correlated in the downtrend. So if demand fundamentals are weakening, what about supply? Well, I think supply or the supply glut, especially in the United States, has, of course, also compelled many investors to position bearishly around oil and why the oil price is weak. Here we look at the inventory levels in U.S. The inventory levels have risen dramatically, actually relative to previous cycles. We see that inventory levels now are above around 18% higher than the seasonally adjusted levels we've seen in previous years. So it already tells you there is quite a supply glut out there, of course driven very much by the shale revolution, where U.S. has been able to extract an increasing amounts of shale out of the soil. And what is very interesting is to see how increasingly the United States is becoming energy sufficient, and at the rate at which the production is growing, U.S. will soon become self-sufficient. And we show this nicely in the chart to the right, where as a percentage of imports, to meet global or to meet U.S. consumption, this has steadily declined from around 60% in 2006 all the way to 25% now. So an increasing share of consumption comes from domestic production as opposed to imports. So if you look at the oil price then in terms of the fundamentals, we've highlighted China and emerging markets where consumption growth has contracted last year. We also highlighted the U.S. supply glut. If we then look at the price of oil and compare that over its history, and in fact we adjust the price of oil against consumer prices, or to be specific in this chart here, against U.S. consumer prices, what we are seeing that if we adjust crude oil against consumer prices and look at the real price of oil in today's dollars and convert it back over the history, that we are seeing that at current levels, hovering around anywhere between, say, $45 a barrel now, then we are seeing it's still trading at quite a premium relative to the pre-China supercycle bubble, really. And it may be a reason why we are seeing increased interest in traders looking to play oil bearishly as opposed to pushing themselves bullishly on the commodity. One of the interesting aspects of short leverage ETPs is the ability for investors to build efficient hedge constructs around their commodity positions. And here we try to highlight how you can be relatively capital efficient by building a hedge. Generally, the higher the gearing factor pertaining the leverage ETP, the less capital you need to commit to get the hedged exposure. And so what we've done here is to showcase three scenarios. The first scenario is just an exposure to oil where you are unhedged. This is really indicated by the black dotted line. This is just essentially just the crude oil price. And we know, as we've seen in the previous slide, oil price has dropped quite significantly, around 55% since the start of last year. Now, you could do two things. You could either buy and hold a short leverage ETP over the time frame and see how this will affect the leveraged the hedge portfolio over that time frame. And what happens is if you were to buy a triple short ETP tracking crude oil, and say you have $100 initially invested in crude oil and you buy a triple short and you want to be fully hedged against your long position, it means you essentially buy $25 into the short ETP tracking crude oil to hedge your 75 exposure, long exposure. And if this is just a buy and hold strategy, then over time, as the oil price has declined, you've been progressively essentially under-hedged, and to your advantage, right? Because the oil price has dropped, and so you've over-hedged, and so you have then essentially gained as out of the over-hedge, and so your net position stands to gain in the falling oil price. And this is indicated by the orange line. So in a buy-and-hold strategy, you would actually be gaining in this scenario. But of course, those investors who cannot, as most investors cannot anticipate the direction of any commodity or any asset class short term, you would want to rebalance so as to sustain the hedge. And what we've done here in the chart on the bottom is to showcase those events where you would need to rebalance the portfolio to get essentially a straight line, which is on the top chart, the dark black line. It's essentially a straight line. And how do you achieve such a hedge? Is through periodically rebalancing by either buying or selling short ETPs. The green bars shows episodes where you would need to add to your short positions. And of course, this is in the case where the oil price has risen steadily. You can see that the dotted line in essentially the first bit of the chart is rising. It means the value of your short has come down. In order to stay hedged, you need to add to your short position. So there have been two events where you have needed to add to your short position to essentially sustain your hedge. But progressively, over time, as the oil price keeps falling and that momentum accelerates, unless you sell your short positions, your short position, the value of your short position exceeds the value of your long position, although net-to-net, you stand to gain, as indicated by the orange line. If you don't know what the outcome is in the oil price and you progressively adjust your portfolio, you would need to reduce your shorts. And so there have therefore been about 8 episodes where you would need to reduce your short position to sustain your hedge portfolio. Over a time frame of 1 year, it would compel some investors, you know, to adjust their portfolios accordingly. And the message therefore is a volatile asset class such as oil requires a lot of monitoring by investors. And investors seeking to protect their portfolio would really need to make sure that they need to rebalance once in a while to make sure they sustain the value of the portfolio longer term. I'll basically now hand over to Zach Hascoe, Head of Capital Markets, who will be talking more about aspects around volume and liquidity. Zach, on to you.
Thank you, Viktor. So I thought it would be helpful to show some real-time examples of investors utilizing the products from my perspective on the capital markets desk. So here's an example of a big day-over-day price change in 3OIL, our 3x leveraged oil product. You can see that there was a price decrease of almost 13% day over day in mid-February. And then that led to over a 200% volume increase the very next day. So on the next slide, you'll be able to see more clearly what's actually happening here. So you can see by the arrow in the middle of the chart that there was a big decrease in the price of oil, which led to a big decrease in our product, 3OIL, and investors saw this as an opportunity to get into the market. So you see big activity, big volume, lots of market participants coming in and getting into the product at that level, watching the technicals and getting into the product. If you look left, towards the bottom of the slide, if you look all the way left, you don't see the white bars nearly as high as they are in the middle of February. And that means that there was never a volume day of that size. So what this is showing is that investors are carefully watching the markets, they're picking their entry and exit points, and they're tactically getting in at levels they want to get in, monitoring their positions on a daily basis. That's extremely important. And then getting out of the products when they feel it's most appropriate. And sometimes on a day like this in mid-February, we see investors even buying and selling the product during the same trading day. So there's some really, really short-term tactical traders, and then there's some longer-term tactical traders. But the key is that the product needs to be monitored on a daily basis. And I thought this was a great example to show how the products are being used by investors.
Finally, last but not least, I just want to bring your attention the product suite that we have on offer in the short and leveraged commodity space. Here we just have a product list telling you that we offer different leverage factors on our commodity ETPs pertaining to natural gas and crude oil. Please have a look. You can also go to our website, www.boostetp.com, for further information.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you very much, Viktor and Zachary, for that presentation. It was really in-depth and interesting. I'd just like to ask a couple questions here. The first one is actually Zachary. It's in terms of, despite the growing assets under management in these products, how can investors truly measure the liquidity? Does it purely come down to assets under management, or are there other measures in which we can judge liquidity?
Thank you, Rachel. So it's a really good question. I think first and foremost, investors need to understand what they're investing in. they need to look at the underlying benchmark, they need to look at the underlying asset class, and that will give them a sense of how the product's going to react in different market environments and what the liquidity might look like in different market environments. The next thing investors should do is go directly on exchange and look at the spreads on the exchange, look at the transparency on the exchange. That's one of the best benefits of short and leveraged ETPs, that they're on exchange traded. So the biggest institutional investors down to the smallest individual investors have the same transparency to the same prices and can transact at the same levels on the stock exchange. And that's a huge advantage to these types of products over other types of structures. And then lastly, average daily volume and assets under management aren't always telling the whole story. So it's important to look at the spreads on screen. But we also see bigger investors and more sophisticated investors speaking with market makers directly and sometimes executing in an over-the-counter basis directly with the market maker. So most wealth managers and financial advisors through their dealing desk have access to these types of market makers. And so I spend a lot of my day working with investors to connect them to the right people if they do want to execute in a little bit bigger size. But definitely the exchange is the best place investors should look.
Thank you. And coming out to Viktor, I'm interested in the fact that, say, we speculate the oil price goes up for a few years or it could go down for the next few years as OPEC continues to wrangle with market share, etc. But given the fact that maybe tactical investors using short and leveraged ETPs shouldn't be in them for, you know, too long, but yet the trend is definitely going one way for a few years, how do they know to time the market? How do they know when to get in and out?
Great question. Well, generally, investors do not really know, what trend specifically in commodity is. Commodity prices, the trend of crude oil has been all over the place in recent years, really. Not too long ago, oil was trading at $100 a barrel. And let's look where it is now. It's about half that level. And I think investors who choose to be strategically positioned in the commodities, crude oil, can benefit from crude oil longer term if, of course, there is a trend. But I do think in modern asset allocation nowadays, there can be episodes where there is no momentum in the price in either direction. And what our products offer the investor is to get some momentum in a market that hasn't have any momentum. And the momentum is achieved through the gearing component, right? So if you have a 3x geared exposure to crude oil, at the time when crude oil isn't really doing anything, you can tactically, take a position and at least short term amplify the return, risk return profile of your portfolio. Longer term, we would always sort of advise investors to either sort of use such products more as a hedge, or choose lower leverage factors, maybe just even Delta One products as your best tool to position strategically and very long-term around such commodities.
Great. Now we have a question specifically from the audience, and that's in terms of asset allocation. How much would an investor invest in oil or short leverage ETPs, if not specified here, in terms of a balanced investor? Would you have any tips on quantifying that investment, Viktor?
I think in as an asset class, commodities do offer value to any portfolio simply because it improves the risk-return profile of the portfolio in itself. Consider stocks and bonds. They tend to be relatively lowly correlated, although recently, because of quantitative easing happening everywhere, maybe not the United States, but now again in Europe, it probably is quite wise to consider alternative asset classes to complement the a portfolio consisting of equities and bonds, including commodities. I would always advise investors to look at least the correlation of certain commodities or commodity asset classes within commodities with equities and bonds, and they tend to be generally low. If they're low, it means that you can enhance the risk return profile over the longer term. But in terms of allocation, I think it's probably, you know, you generally want income generating assets, assets that either go give you a dividend or a coupon. So you would probably have generally a larger allocation into equities and fixed income and a generally lower allocation into commodities. I think this precise answer I can't give. It really depends what the purpose is of the portfolio. If it's for retirement planning, I generally think that you should have a small allocation into commodities and a much larger allocation into growth assets such as equities or fixed income. If it's more tactical, the allocation to commodities as a portion of other assets should be much larger.
That answer. And the next question is looking specifically at currencies. That's been a massive theme so far this year with currency shifts, and that obviously comes into play when you invest in short and leverage ETPs. So with that in mind, Viktor, how does currency shift affect an investor going into an oil short and leverage ETP?
I think the easy answer to that is investors need to bear in mind that most commodities trade in US dollars, so their base currency is US dollars. But if the product, of course, trades in euros, you always incur the exchange rate risk. So be mindful that if the euro devalues relative to the dollar and you've exposed yourself to a dollar asset such as WTI crude oil, you have actually stand to gain in this scenario because you hold a product that is actually quoted and traded in dollars. So in that event, you would have to gain. But generally speaking, investors who expose themselves into who buy commodity ETPs need to be aware that these are traded generally in US dollars. So the currency risk is definitely there if the underlying is traded on the exchange, as say in the currency such as euros or pound sterling.
Mentioned in the speech earlier that the more leveraged you go can generally mean that costs are increased, if I understood that correctly. Now, I went to one of your events yesterday and it was mentioned that some countries, they have a much higher appetite for leverage and they go much higher than we have here. And I'm just wondering, when it comes to oil, you know, can we still benefit if we have a much higher leverage factor? Can it go much higher than the current factors we have here? Is that a growing trend, Viktor?
Generally, yeah, that's quite right, Rachel. You know, generally the higher, the better the liquidity underpinning the asset class, the easier it is to offer higher leverage factors because higher liquidity means you can contain costs. And generally, if you produce a product with a higher leverage factor, it always transcends into wider spreads, and it's a cost to the investor. We try to provide cost-efficient products, and unless the product is liquid, or the asset class, I should say, is liquid that you're trying to track, such as an FX currency pair, for instance, where we do offer leverage factor in excess of 3x, we have a product that is a play on the euro-dollar, long or short, with a leverage factor of 5x, that unless the asset class is liquid, we choose to contain the leverage factor and limit ourselves to maybe 2 or 3x. With oil, given it is a liquid product, but it's also a very volatile product, just similar to natural gas, you can achieve, I would say, rather outsized returns in a relatively short space of time just by the volatility of the underlying itself. The leverage of 2 or 3x is enough to get probably double-digit returns in the 20s, sometimes in the 30s, if your holding period is a couple of weeks or a number of days. So we don't think you could necessarily, a higher leverage factor can necessarily benefit the investor when the returns are already quite phenomenal given the 2 or 3x leverage factor that they currently have on offer.
You mentioned the reasons for the fall in terms of that glut of supply and demand. We do have a specific question here about different views being voiced, one from the ministers in Saudi Arabia as to the fall. So I was wondering if you have an alternative view as to what the reason for the fall might be.
I generally share the view that many oil-producing nations have come to grips with a lower oil price. They've seen it in the past. This is not the first time that we've seen oil price trading at these levels. The general analysts have put forward, yeah, they need to sustain their fiscal budgets. I mean, unless the oil price recovers, they won't be able to sustain their fiscal budgets. But don't forget, as the oil price climbed in previous years, they've expanded their expenditure as well. So naturally, the consequence is that countries like Saudi Arabia, for instance, will have to cut back on social spending and on all the subsidies they give in order to balance the budgets again. I think they probably have to accept the fact that the United States will probably continue to use the shale gas technology revolution to their advantage, because it's such a strategic asset to have. So I think the lower oil price will have definitely put smaller shale producers into bankruptcy, but I think what it merely has done is to slow the rate of growth of shale production. I don't think it will have reversed it. And as a result, the supply glut is probably, in my view, a longer-term phenomenon rather than a short-term phenomenon, despite of the lower price we've seen, and that as a result, the oil-producing nations are adjusting themselves accordingly and just sustain the relatively large production just so they can maintain some of the lost oil revenues.
Okay, let's turn now to due diligence and actually drilling down into these vehicles themselves. When it comes to the index underlying the fund, Zach, how exactly does that work and what kind of due diligence is required?
So we typically take major world benchmarks, major indexes. We're usually looking at the most liquid indexes because that will translate into the liquidity of the product. And then, as Viktor mentioned, we're guaranteeing that return on a daily basis. And so, again, if it's a volatile market environment and the market's trending up and down and up and down and you're holding this product over a long period of time, there's going to be some price decay in your return. And that's a really important point for investors to understand. Even though the index is liquid and the product's liquid, the daily rebalance is extremely important. So if you go up 10% and then go back down 10%, you're not back to where you started. And so, you know, a lot of education is needed, and investors really have to monitor their positions closely because of that daily leverage factor.
Okay, time for just one last question. Now, we've talked about oil a lot, obviously, theme of the webinar, but this opens a whole new world in a sense, because the effect of the price of oil has a much wider effect across capital markets, across exporting and importing economies, across emerging markets. So does this lead on for other opportunities for investors in using short and leverage ETPs in other areas where they think there might be a knock-on effect and therefore an extra benefit, Viktor?
Well, to the extent that sharp declines or unexpected declines in oil price lead to all kinds of macro uncertainties, such as, for instance, what we've seen in Russia, for instance, yeah, that's a great way for opportunistic investors to also consider leverage exposure to Russian equities, for instance, or the ruble-dollar rate, for instance. All these markets are related. And we've seen some in our global flows report that we produce on a monthly basis, where essentially we showcase the trends underpinning the short and leveraged ETP industry by asset class and by country and by flows and a growth in AUM. We have seen some, you know, flows and shifting between Russian equities on the one hand, either bullish or bearishly, and flows in ruble-dollar rates, and not just oil. So there is definitely this, you know, the spillover effect taking place in the short leverage ETPs, and it's, from a technical opportunistic point of view, a very efficient means for investors to quickly position themselves. Bear in mind, our short leverage ETPs are cash products. You won't be able to lose more than you've initially invested. So it's a very simple, controlled way of gaining extra exposure with a nice degree of leverage, but not excessively so that you can't manage it. So I think knowing the mechanics that we just discussed, it's a great way for public investors to, you know, to build exposure with decent leverage.
I'd like to thank both Zachary and Viktor today for their contributions. It was very insightful. I want to remind the attendees that this course is CPD accredited, and we will email you instructions. And the session has been recorded, so that will be on our site within 24 hours, and you can catch up on the content then. And that leaves me to just say thank you very much, and we welcome to see you at